So welcome, everyone. I'm John Uriarte, curator of digital programs at the Photographers Gallery. Thanks for joining us for day two of Concerning Photography, photographic networks in Britain. I'm very excited to be here for what promises to be a very interesting day of debates and discussions, ending with a presentation by artist Penny Slinger. Before we move to Maitreyi Maheshwari, who'll say more on the themes for this morning's panels on materiality and process and its panelists, I just wanted to say a few words regarding the collaboration and how we came to the ideas that will be explored today. The initial idea for this conference started in Study Day in 2017, in which Mark Haller from Paul Mellon Center and Brett Rogers, the Photographers Gallery director, discussed the idea of organizing a conference to coincide with the 50th anniversary of the gallery. I'm really excited to be here today when, with the great work of my colleagues and the staff from the Paul Mellon Center, that original idea has turned into a great conference to celebrate new scholarship in the study of photography. And I just want to add that the panelists this morning are particularly excited to me, as we are going to be looking at the emergence of processes like slide tape and the establishment of digital programs at photography institutions as we reframe the definition of photography. Before we move to our speakers, we have a few words on housekeeping for today. The session contains three 15-minute papers on the material process, process panel, followed by a Q&A. This will be followed by a short 10-minute comfort break, and then we return after the break for the final two papers and a further Q&A. And the audience members can type questions using the Q&A function. And yes, so you know that this session is being recorded, that will be made available to the public. Also, you have closed captioning available, clicking on the CC button on the bottom right of your screen to enable captions. I just want to say thank you to Sarah Turner, to Shona Blankenfield, Daniel Convey, and the rest of the team at the Paul Mellon Center, to my colleagues at the Photographers Gallery who put this together, especially to our talks and events curator, Luis Auliette, and to this morning's speakers and the audience. And I think that's all what I have to say. And now to Maitreyi Maheshwari, head of program at FACT in Liverpool.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for the invitation. And I'm really excited also to be part of this conference and particularly to be able to moderate this panel, this morning's panel on material process. As the head of program at FACT Liverpool, we're a space that specializes and considers new media technology and the role of technology in art. So today's discussions and today's papers have a lot of poignancy for me in thinking through how representational technologies have moved over the last 50 years and the kind of evolution of representational technology, particularly thinking about sort of developments in photography, in video, moving image, and now networked images. The papers in this session each explore aspects of photography that draw a connection between the materiality of photographic works and the visibility or invisibility of the systems and processes that produce them, to consider the medium's cultural and political capital within a canon of art as much as within a communication technology. From the analog print to the slide to video and now digitally networked images, what we consider to be a photograph and our relationship to the image and its form has evolved rapidly. The presentations discuss the importance of context produced by the curator, space, or the institution in shaping discourse and defining the terms in which we come to understand photography, and the challenges in building visual literacy in an image-saturated world. As a medium for self-actualization, its ubiquity encourages a democracy of access, allowing those typically excluded from more established art forms to be able to represent themselves. Yet it's also a medium of exploitation in its material processes, which tie it to capitalist supply chains and cultures of consumption. So this morning we've got, as John said, we've got two papers first up, and I'm going to introduce the first two speakers then we'll have a brief Q&A around those two papers, and then a short break. Then we'll come back and introduce our second two speakers, and then have a sort of bigger Q&A session following that. So it's my absolute pleasure to introduce the first of our two speakers, Mo White, who is an artist, writer, and lecturer. Mo works in moving image and photographic media and has exhibited widely, including exhibitions in New York, Dublin, Athens, Belfast, and Birmingham. Her work, her research concerns gender, diasporic and queer identities, and the effects and their effect on contemporary artists and art practices. And she was awarded a PhD in 2007 for her research examining artists using the moving image in the UK since the 1970s, and has since published on slide tape, most recently in Practices of Projection, Histories and Technologies, which was published in 2020 by Oxford University Press. Mo is a lecturer in fine art at Loughborough University. Following Mo, we'll have a presentation by Katrina Sluis, who is Associate Professor and Head of Photography and Media Arts at the School of Art and Design at the Australian National University. She was previously Senior Lecturer and Founding Co-Director of the Centre for the Study of the Networked Image, CSNI, at London South Bank University. From 2011 to 2019, she also held the inaugural post of Senior Curator of Digital Programmes at the Photographers Gallery, London. And she's also presently Adjunct Research Curator there. So without further ado, I will hand over to Mo. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Maitreyi. Good morning, everyone. I hope you can see my screen okay, that I've now shared. So the title of my paper is The Use of Photography in Artists' Slide Tape Works in the UK since the 1970s. This paper will look at the use of photography in slide tape works by artists during the late 1970s and 1980s in the UK. Slide tape is a series of projected 35 millimeter photographic slides with a synchronized audio soundtrack with two or more projectors and a pulse command on the tape soundtrack, allowing images to fade between one and another and synchronize with the sound. As a technology, it is significant in the UK for being used by a number of key and emerging artists for a brief period before being abandoned. This moment itself has been largely forgotten, and the paper will consider this and the importance of slide tape as an experimental tool used in artists' projected works. There had been projected works in America that prefigured this moment in the UK. Those identified by Chrissy Isles for the exhibition Into the Light, the Projected Image in American Art, 1964 to 1977, and later those identified by Darcy Alexander in the curation of the exhibition Slideshow in 2005, which found a large body of artists' work in slide projection from the 1960s to the early 2000s from both North America and Europe. These works in these exhibitions showed a different set of concerns, both the formal qualities and the potential offered by the slide itself, and were described by Darcy Alexander as a bridge between photography and film. Unlike the works in slide tape, these projected works did not use a sound or audio element, and this suggests that slide tape is a distinct form used only in the UK. If, as Alexander says, the slides being projected from a carousel are doing so in time, they are also moments taken out of time as photographs. As to state the obvious, the slide transparency is indeed photographic, and it relies on photography, and its use can be said to combine the qualities of both the still photograph and cinematic film. Slide tape has a context. In the late 1970s in the UK, slide tape was relieved of its conventional use as an education and presentational tool and used to make experimental artworks. This became a moment when avant-garde artists in the UK in particular found a different technology with which to explore images and sound. During the 1960s and early 70s, artists had developed a range of art practices in time-based media, including performance, film, video, and installation. These histories attest to the development of media forms that were in clear opposition to the history and traditions of painting and sculpture, where artists develop experimental practices to address the contemporary social and political landscape. It was in this context that artists' use of slide tape emerged in the UK. However, slide tape as a form has been overlooked by many writers, curators, and critics in their formulations of artists' work during this period. The period during which slide tape work circulated in galleries in the UK is marked by two key exhibitions: About Time, video performance and installation by 21 women artists, an exhibition initially staged at the Institute of Contemporary Arts, London, in 1980. In 1990, the Museum of Modern Art, Oxford, staged Signs of the Times, a decade of video, film, and slide tape installation in Britain, 1980 to 1990, curated by Chrissy Isles, which, although not entirely retrospective, was signaling the end of slide tape's useful life as an art form. After this, slide tape, with very few exceptions, no longer existed as a form seen in galleries and exhibitions. It can also be noted that slide tape had not always been restricted to gallery context. It was a form that was also used in community art and education projects. Maggie Hum writes of a project that took place in 1989. Women's studies students from the University of East London worked with local community photographers on a slide tape project to produce work that was described as transformative. Hum notes in her description that while slide tape was cheap, crude, and eccentric, it was useful in separating sounds and images and their effects, which could be interrogated and brought together in the making of visual political theory. For artists, slide tape was a relatively cheap way to produce work that could be made without the need for external funding. As Chrissy Isles pointed out in retrospect, it was a self-supporting practice, and slide tape resources were housed in educational institutions and could be accessed by artists to make their work. In 1980, a group of women initiated the exhibition Women's Images of Men at the ICA London, and this led to the exhibition About Time later in 1980. About Time made an important contribution to a gender-based critique and engaged its analysis in an area of practice, time-based media, where male artists had been seen to dominate much of its development. About Time included slide tape work by Judith Higginbottom, Pat Whiteread, Tina Keane, and Roberta Graham. Here on the screen, the stills from Tina Keane's slide tape work of 1980, Clapping Songs, shows the playground actions of two girls accompanied by a soundtrack of their singing of the humorous songs. Amongst the other 21 women artists in About Time, Roberta Graham exhibited shortcuts to sharp looks, a work made in 1979, which mounted a critique against cosmetic surgery. The projected images of sharp metal knives and human flesh were accompanied on the tape by what was described as a hideously graphic soundtrack. The use of slide tape by avant-garde artists came with early support from the London Filmmakers Cooperative. The co-op is important in occupying a central place in the history of British avant-garde film during the period. When the co-op held a summer show in 1980, it included slide tape as an area related to film, alongside video, photography, and expanded cinema, all of which were activities that the co-op had embraced since the 1960s. Amongst the varying work on show was Judith Higginbottom's Sea Dreams and Tina Keane's Clapping Songs, as seen here in an extract from the catalogue, along with others using a form which was described as either slide tape, tape slide, or installation. During the same period, the Black Audio Film Collective were producing slide tape work. Their first project as a collective group used slide tape forms prior to their well-known film work, Handsworth Songs, of 1984. Expeditions, Signs of Empire, and Images of Nationality were made between 1982 and 1984 and explored colonialism, empire, hybridity, and exile. They sourced historical archival imagery with which to establish an archaeology of colonial subjectivity. And this has been described by Okwi Enwazor as an intertextuality where text, sound, and image slide across the space of the other. Keith Piper, an artist closely associated with the Black Audio Film Collective at the time, produced a mixed media installation, The Trophies of Empire, in 1985, where projected slides, a plaster bust, and a record deck playing Elgar's Pomp and Circumstance provided the soundtrack. This was a highly critical work, described by Piper himself as a work of its political moment, made in the Thatcher years of high unemployment, race riots, and the privatization of nationalized industries. By the time Chrissy Isles came to curate Signs of the Times, she presented the idea that time-based media, by which she meant video and film, had clearly developed from these earlier practices in slide tape. Isles considered the work in slide tape had by that time, in 1990, become less a set of critical tools than a series of illusionistic devices. Holly Warburton's work, Viridus, on the screen now, was one of the slide tape projections in the exhibition and concerned with Baroque imagery and, given Isles' commentary, had a place in music, fashion, and new romantic pop culture. It used sophisticated dissolve techniques which were used in marketing by the corporate sector. Even there, by this time, the use of this technology was ending. Artists themselves had been using video since the early 1970s. So when Isles acknowledged that slide tape's precedents were in the earlier politicized work that had overturned contemporary art practice, her statements were also clearly signaling an ending of those projects. Given the demise of slide tape since the 1990s and its current status as a technology that is both forgotten and overlooked, restaging of such work is a rare event. Nina Danino has recently restaged First Memory, a work originally made in 1980 and shown at the ICA alongside the About Time exhibition. First Memory pieces together a narrative through picturing a series of objects and rooms in a house, accompanied by a woman's voice that describes a child's view in retrospect. Graphs show the editing sequence of this work was shown in the 2010 restaging of First Memory at Ambika P3 Gallery in London. These graphs show an intricate structure, a challenge to the notion that slide tape work is crude or inferior. Danino's work was further included in the exhibition Slide Tape at Vivid Projects in Birmingham in 2013. This was the result of my curatorial collaboration with Yasmin Bay Clifford of Vivid Projects. Based on my research into this area at the time, it offered a fresh appraisal of this abandoned medium. The exhibition also included work by Tina Keane, Cordelia Swan, the Black Audio Film Collective, Kathy Wade, William Furlong and the Audio Arts, and here in the foreground, Sunil Gupta's 1980s work, London Gay Switchboard, which documented the organization's activities as well as images of the gay club and pub scene. A recent article by Glyn Davis has unearthed the queer fragments in Gupta's work with its rediscovered soundtrack as a fragile smorgasbord of visual and audio delights. There are no institutional archives or holdings of slide tape works in the UK, at least in their original format. The very few that are held are now in the Tate Archive. These include few of the more critical artists I have mentioned, in fact, only one, the slide tape work by the Black Audio Film Collective, which was acquired by Tate in 2009. This should be no surprise, as the work themselves are difficult to store, archive, and allow access to. And the original slide tape projector units in working order are rare, mostly obsolete pieces of equipment. Slide tape has always been difficult to categorize. It was once what was called lens-based media, and now is still called time-based media. Slide tape uses time as a material, but it also has the ability to animate time in much the same way as the medium of film, using sound, space, and its projection technology to achieve that. Slide tape has fallen between definitions of the still image and moving image cultures. I have argued elsewhere that slide tape has a relationship to moving images, so that it could be said to provide a legacy to this media. As here in this slide, showing the work of the otherwise filmmaker Cordelia Swan, and the work is called Mysteries of Berlin. It has even been described, that's not just Cordelia Swan's work, but slide tape work, has been described by proto-cinematic by Okwi Enwazor in his commentary on the work of Black Audio Film Collective. Falling between these spaces, slide tape has been described by Rosalind Krauss as a singular practice. This is not a very satisfactory description, as in itself it eludes the fact that slide tape was used largely by women artists and Black artists as individuals, and if not in collectives themselves, then in a collective endeavor in response to the political situation they found themselves in. This factor is one that I speculate, combined with the format's initial cheapness and technical instability, that has led to its dismissal as an art form, as well as its demise as a technical form.
Thank you. Could I invite Katrina to give her presentation now?
Hi, everyone. Can I get any indicator that you can hear me and see me?
That's great, Katrina. Thank you.
Real great. Thank you. Well, thank you, Maitreyi and Mo, for that introduction. And in addition to my fellow speakers, I'd like to thank the gallery and Paul Hamlin Foundation for today. And my paper is called Glimmering Screens, Institutional Dreams, Curating Post-Photography. So in 2011, I found myself standing in a pile of rubble, wearing a hard hat and high-vis jacket on the site which was to become the new photographer's gallery. After an £8.9 million fundraising campaign, the organisation was rebuilding and rebranding itself and had announced its ambitions to embrace 21st century digital culture. The gallery manager, Jason, stood next to me, a haunted look in his eyes, nervously clutching a set of architectural drawings. He gestured at the concrete shell before us and said, "Katrina, see that wall over there? Do you think you can do anything with it?" I had just been appointed the gallery's first digital curator, at a point where post-photographic discourse was already over two decades old. The digital revolution had destabilized older ontologies of the medium, generating anxieties about truth, human agency, and techno-capitalist power. And yet, despite the technical death of photography, practices of collecting and exhibiting had remained largely the same. Perhaps this is not surprising. The fight for photography to join the canon of modernist art meant its status as technology of reproduction was generally downplayed. Instead, the photographer was positioned as a virtuoso, and the photograph framed as a creative vision captured by mechanical means. The overwhelming arrival of the bastardized, contextless networked image therefore posed huge risks for those museums who had championed photography as an art form. It's worth noting that the digital was not always incompatible with photography's institutional and market success. As Julian Stalabras observes, artists such as Jeff Wall, Andreas Gursky, and Gregory Crutzen seamlessly combined analog and digital processes and were celebrated as photographic pioneers who produced works with the scale and authority of historical painting. The digital malleability of the image, rather than prompting a crisis of authorship in the museum, rescued the photograph from older anxieties about artistic intentionality. Digital post-production offered up the possibility that no pixel had been left untouched by the hand of the artist, even if those interventions were not made explicit. Under the guise of a new photographic avant-garde, cultural institutions were therefore able to absorb the digital turn, which at that point did not threaten the existing economies of the print. However, whilst museum photography was busy scaling itself up to colonize the white cube, photography and digital culture was colonizing every sphere of life. At the precise point where photography secured its institutional acceptance, it also became ubiquitous, immense, liquid, streaming through interfaces and glorified through hypercirculation. Under data capitalism, the photograph has been reconstituted as a calculable surface, subject to Boolean algebra and algorithmic modes of ordering, taking part in regimes of massive value extraction as part of big data and AI industries. However, this is not to suggest that digital culture has been entirely ignored. Major museums have turned to thematic exhibitions in which image surplus and information is subjected to an art historical lens. These shows tend to position socio-technical change as always already the privileged project of the artist and map the inevitable trajectory from Fluxus to male art to our friend Eric Kessels. Others have invested their marketing budgets in promoting the talent of a new generation of digital natives, reinforcing their own curatorial power as contemporary tastemakers in the process, even as curating itself has become diffused and operationalized in network culture. So in England, work in this arena has been, however, constrained by cultural policy, which positions the digital as a tool, not as a culture. This is embodied by the approach of the Digital R&D Fund for the Arts, a widely criticized initiative from 2012 to 2014 by NESTA, Arts Council England, and the AHRC, which promoted the digital in terms of new apps and ticketing systems for cultural orgs, or projects which put drones in the hands of artists, where technology once more became a tool of the avant-garde. A quick Google of these projects today will take you through a ruined landscape of broken links and abandoned websites, apart from one project, Culture Counts, which became the preferred metrics dashboard to answer the problem of measuring cultural value in the sector. But perhaps this is not surprising. Under conditions of austerity and the logic of new managerialism, KPIs and other impact metrics continue to discipline the ambitions of UK cultural organisations. And as an aside, I am still haunted by the moment where Peter Bazalgette, then chair of the Arts Council, suggested to my colleagues and I in the cafe of the gallery, "You need to remember you are not competing with other mid-scale galleries for audiences. You were competing with YouTube." Today, Arts Council England continues to promote the tracking of audiences via Google Analytics over open source alternatives, whilst Google itself is in the process of colonizing cultural institutions with its own digital cameras that promise to reproduce museum objects in succulent detail, producing a simulation of the analogue museum at the front end, even as it harvests and privatises the valuable metadata generated by public engagement with collections at the back end. And what of the role of museum marketing teams who have historically embraced technology as a tool for monitoring and increasing audience reach and engagement? In this arena, the digital is positioned as a tool to repackage existing cultural content and encourage new forms of cultural consumption. From VR simulations of gallery spaces and celebrity exhibition walkthroughs on Instagram Live, we have seen how formerly disinterested cultural institutions have pivoted online out of pandemic necessity. Crucially, digital transformation here is valorized under the mantra of innovation, in which a broadcast model of consumer engagement is favored over the dialogic potential of network culture, ensuring the cultural value of the art object remains intact. So the recent appointment of digital curators in photo museums in Europe would seem to suggest a growing interest by the sector to engage with these problems. Recognizing that technical change cuts across all areas of the organization, from programming to education. But beyond the absurdity of having to uphold medium specificity in a post-media age, what role or agency might digital curating have in the photo museum? And so in answering this question, I will circle back to the gallery's digital program, which celebrates its 10th anniversary next year under the leadership of John Uriarte and Sam Mercer. Set up as a collaboration between the Center for the Study of the Networked Image at Southbank University and the gallery in 2012, it represents the first attempt by a photo institution to systematically address the digital turn through a dedicated program of collaborative practice-centered research. It is worth noting that space for this sort of longitudinal research is impossible in the day-to-day running of underfunded organizations focused on short-term projects needing to generate footfall, press impact, and data collection. And I know the gallery was fortunate to have received funding by Esme Fairbairn Foundation to set up the program. At its launch, the digital program's focus was to develop a programming strategy for the media wall, the ground floor space, which Brett Rogers had conceived as a project space for screen media. As it expanded, the program explored new formats, including Geekenders, which were weekend gallery takeovers, an online platform called Unthinking Photography, exhibitions, an experimental photo school, and more recently, formats such as screen walks with Photo Museum Winterthur. Its concerns span from lolcats to GIF culture, computer vision and computational propaganda, post-capitalist photography and digital labor, and more recently, the politics of imaging the planet itself. It has taken undertaken experimental commissions with artists, most notably Jonas Lund, who in 2019 staged Operation Earnest Voice, a four-day installation which turned the gallery into an influencing agency staffed by members of the public tasked with reversing Brexit using the tools weaponized by Cambridge Analytica. I like to think of this project as a gallery visual literacy project. And these projects, in their own flawed ways, tried to probe the logic of the institution and suggest a different agenda. But in considering the problems I outlined in my introduction, I want to conclude by focusing on a project which offers insight into the agency of digital curating and collaborative research in the photo museum. Dataset Match was a year-long program of commissions, workshops, and symposia, which ran from 2019 to 2020, whose aim was to bring into sharp focus the computer scientist as a crucial yet overlooked figure in photographic culture, and position them as a significant author, curator, and mediator of images. It did this through an examination of the computer vision dataset, a collection of photographs used to train machines how to classify and categorize the world. In doing so, we sought to demystify and illuminate the concrete infrastructures of image automation. It positioned AI as a fundamentally photographic project, relying on the labor of photographic communities such as PhotoNet and Flickr, in producing the training data or ground truth, which animates machine vision. As many cultural organizations began to celebrate Silicon Valley's AI hype, we were keen to bring our focus to the dataset as a material and political constellation of images, linked closely to older knowledge practices and taxonomies of photography. dataset Match became a platform for disseminating the work of Nicola Malave, who undertook a gallery-sponsored PhD from 2016 to 2020 in order to investigate what it means to think about photography and machine vision from the position who annotates images industrially. Referring, of course, here to the huge distributed workforce mobilized on Amazon Mechanical Turk, paid 1/10 of a cent to describe the contents of images to machines. And this was a platform which also incidentally was used by Magnum to annotate their own photographic archive. As part of this project, Nicola began restaging a 2007 experiment conducted by computer scientists in the gallery that studied what can be understood from a photograph in a millisecond glance, which later became informed the development of ImageNet, a canonical dataset in computer vision. This is the paper that the experiment is based on. Nicola reenacted this experiment in order to ask what kind of vision informs these systems and how does this impact on the way machines see the world. This re-experiment was conducted with gallery staff, members of the public, and ultimately Dr. Fei-Fei Li, ImageNet's creator, at the gallery at our invitation in 2019. And Fei-Fei Li was actually on her way to Rome at the time to speak to the Pope about AI. And so from a curatorial perspective, dataset Match took on the problem of how to see or exhibit a dataset of 14 million images, work with artists to make it intelligible, and open up these questions with an audience, setting in motion a series of socio-technical and institutional problems which reveal the limits of how the photograph is framed both culturally and by the computer sciences. Using the gallery's media wall, the digital program team worked to develop a script which cycled through ImageNet at a speed of 90 milliseconds per image, traversing the entire dataset of 14 million images in a period of 2 months. And for us, it was really an experiment to see, like, you know, the media wall will soon be commissioned. What haven't we done with it? And that is to really experiment with scale in the institution and the politics of scale. The constant failures and fixes that were necessary to maintain the ambitious project challenged the infrastructure of the gallery whilst also revealing something of the politics of curating the networked image. At a time when the sector is in desperate need to reach new audiences, the project was able to engage the computer science community during a period when the politics of datasets, their epistemologies have been called out for the racist, sexist categories they perpetuate and their harvesting of photo sharing communities. And whilst the impact of this work is yet to be determined, essays and artworks which were part of the program are now being cited by researchers in AI ethics, including this recent publication by Google colleagues who had been working with Timnit Gebru, who lost her job at Google famously for her own critical work on the curatorial practices of machine learning. In his PhD thesis, Nicola makes the case for the photographic institution as a site where the experimental apparatuses of computer vision can be questioned, engaged with, in ways that are not possible within the narrow margins of the computer lab. But he argues this can only happen if the institution conceives of its role, not exclusively in terms of an art institution, but as a site where, and I quote, different alignments of practices, devices, and ways of seeing, coming and going under the name photography, can be explored in their active role in the modelling of the technologies of vision. In bringing this paper to a close, I want to argue that at a time when photographic images no longer appear to represent or mediate anymore, but instead track, activate, oversee, control, detect, and identify, there is a danger for photo museums in fetishizing images over imaging systems that they cannot move beyond the analog mirage of the photograph produced by machines for our screens in order to grasp a new and very necessary politics of post-representation. And that's it, thank you.
Thank you so much, Katrina. And I'd like to welcome back Mo for the Q&A. So Katrina, if you could rejoin us for the Q&A. We're going to do a very brief Q&A now, and then we'll take a short 15-minute break. I wanted to start by sort of saying, just in kind of summary, both of your presentations, amazing kind of sort of to track the kind of history of photographic media from the slide tips to something very analog to the kind of now completely dematerialized form of the digital images and that you were talking about, Katrina. But both raised for me questions about photography's place in the canon of art and how artists are often very early adopters of new formats and media, regardless of their acceptance more broadly as art. And it offers, you know, that these new media and formats offer spaces that are largely hidden or spaces for artists whose voices are excluded in other forms of cultural production. And I guess one of my questions is, to what extent do you think institutions need to take responsibility for the supporting of experimentation of artists as they use different technologies to examine the social and political impact of those technologies, rather than perhaps focus on producing archives of the most popular? I don't know who wants to start. I might just pick
one. I can jump in, Mo, if you'd like.
Oh, okay. Carry on.
Well, I think to take one example of smuggling in the most popular, I imagine, would be the show that we did on lolcats, for example, which for us was really to smuggle in a politics of reproduction and a content industrial complex, and address that, whilst also bringing in a new audience to the gallery, who were actually positioned as stakeholders who know a lot about the politics of this technology, who are actual practitioners, if you put it that way. And I think that's one of the strengths of an institution like the Photographers Gallery, where, you know, all our audience are photographers and in many ways have unique perspectives and experience in things like network culture and the politics of memes and their aggregation. So I think it's important to actually go where the popular is, to actually go where I even suggested, why haven't we even done a show of Kim Kardashian? It would A, bring a completely different audience to the gallery, but also enable a really interesting program engaging with what is happening to the image. So for me, I purposely always was interested in the popular and what was happening in photography outside the artist in relation to technology. And which is not to say we didn't do that as well, but we felt that there was a really important job to be done with that.
Mm. Yeah, from the point of view of what I was talking about the time in the context in which slide tape work was developed, the kinds of cultural institutions that we now have and the kind of access to them just didn't exist. Tape Modern wasn't there at the time. Many galleries, the kind of accessibility that there is to culture, it was still an elitist. It was an elite that had access to culture in that way. You know, the kinds of things that, the kind of cultural institutions that generation of artists would have been presumed to have access to would be things like Cork Street. So that was how a very elite. So, you know, the whole landscape has changed. So I'm not quite sure where that leads me, but it just is an extremely different context to the one that you're now describing, Katrina. And even for contemporary practitioners and people in the arts who have access to places like the Photographers' Gallery and can have those kind of dialogues and conversations, that did not exist. It existed in very small kind of bubbles, you know, one of which I described London Filmmakers Co-op at the time was one such place where artists could meet. But this was a very small, kind of quite exclusive bubble of people who talked to one another, but they had no access to a popular audience outside of it.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. The landscape and our relationship to the image has changed and transformed so radically over the last 40, 50 years. So it's kind of, it's wonderful to sort of be able to trace that trajectory. Excuse me, there is someone who has got a chainsaw outside my window, which is, if you can hear that, I'm really sorry.
Can't hear it.
But just to follow up very quickly, we've got a few questions in the Q&A. One from Brett Rogers. One of your aims, Katrina, was also to try and change the organizational culture within the institution through your program. Do you think you achieved this within your time at the Photographers Gallery? And if not, what were the challenges you faced, and what might all photography venues need to think about in addressing this moving forward?
Thank you, Brett, for that question. Whoa, big question. No, I do not think I changed the organisational culture with the institution through the program, unfortunately. I think the closest where that might have happened was Jonas Lund's project, where I actually got most of the institution to become actors and participants in it. But I think the main problem is institutions model the digital differently across their different departments. So you have education, you have marketing and programming, all approaching it from a slightly different way. And yet this amorphous term, the digital, always gets mobilized in meetings and elsewhere without any specification of whether you're talking about digital technologies, digital culture, digital literacy. And so I think what photography venues do need to think about in addressing this moving forward is to, strategically understand how they want to address the digital. As I outlined in my paper, each of those ways I described is a very kind of conservative model of the digital. And what really needs, that's why I proposed the example of collaborative research as being a way for institutions to create space to experiment and change, rather than going temporary exhibition, Instagram takeover, or the palette of different formats. So that's my answer.
Thank you, Katrina. I've got a couple of questions here from Andrew Dudney. I'm going to just read out the first one. Image technologies have been central to the shaping of photography education and indeed to art history. How much do you think the histories of photography should include what was happening in art schools and polytechnics? And actually the second question sort of links quite nicely to this. Isn't the general term artist a problem here? Slide tape was used largely by those excluded from art institutions, and those who adopted network practices have had decamped from other art institutions. So maybe Mo, if I direct this to you, I'm gonna go back on mute.
Okay, I'll just kind of address that question about people who use slide tape did not have access to art institutions. No, that's not entirely the case. That was the case. There were projects, community projects and so on, where slide tape was used, and work with community photographers. I described one of them, but many of the artists who use slide tape did have access to art schools. In fact, some of the best art schools, the Royal College, for instance, which had terrific resources for artists like Nina Danino and Sunil Gupta to use. So, and many of the artists I did mention would have had that kind of access to resources. So what was the other question?
The other question was about whether the history of photography should include what was happening in schools and polytechnics at the time. We use photography very much as a means of sort of understanding both the kind of shaping of art history and the you know the question about it's shaping photography education, but how much do we talk about photography as a sort of way of, well, how do we talk about the education systems as well as a means of understanding what was happening in photography?
I'm not sure I could answer. That's quite a broad question. I'm not sure I could answer that, actually. What I will say is that some, particularly some things that were happening at that time, and I'm thinking of the Black Arts Group, which developed from what was Wolverhampton Polytechnic at the time, which included artists like Keith Piper, Sonia Boyce, Eddie Chambers, and so on. And that emerged from a fine art course at that time. That idea, which has led to some further developments and the careers, has affected the careers of quite a number of Black British artists. So in that sense, yes, and there was quite a lot of other critical work going on at the time in art schools with, more broadly, and this is kind of in a fine art sphere rather than necessarily just photography, but the work of Charles Harrison, Paul Wood, which has also had some influence, and that all started in art schools. So there was a period when art schools were indeed quite radical. Not so the case anymore. But anyway, we'll move on quickly. So hopefully that's has addressed that question in some way anyway.
Katrina, do you want to add to that as someone who now works within a fine art established institution and did so previously as well with South Bank University?
Yeah, I think... It was quite interesting working at the gallery because a lot of students were coming to the digital program events because they weren't getting any of that in the art school, actually, and were saying that you know they're forced now to look at Susan Sontag and see what she would say about Google Street View, for example. So I think I would agree that what was happening in art schools right now is very crucial to the history of photography, but perhaps in a different way. And the way in which photography is taught in universities now, you know, this kind of, this modernist sense of authorship, etc., really remains as a tool of expression. And I think the question remains, you know, for artists, or photographers in particular, you know, what if photography doesn't even like you? It wants to steal your face. What does it mean not to celebrate this medium and be thinking about it in a different way? So,
yeah, that's a there's a sort of sense in which the archive and the canon has always been very celebratory, and now I think there's a kind of shift towards this sort of more critical engagement, looking at, you know, exactly that. What if this is a threat rather than a something to be championed? We've got another question from Liz Wells, and this one's directed at you, Katrina, again. Thanks, Katrina, I enjoyed that. Boundaries between art as valued in the gallery world and popular culture have always been fluid, despite the attempts of some art historians to retain value hierarchies. In terms of the political import of the digital, would you say a little more about the politics of culture and aesthetics, and also the power of private funding given increasing dependence on sponsorship? And this is a continuation of the question that you responded to for Brett.
Yeah, I think, Liz, that really does relate to possibly Brett's question. And I think one of the things I was sort of hinting at is the way in which there is huge amounts of pressure on digital programs to partner with Google and other, you know, great new tech, work with this organization who's doing VR with this or whatever. And, you know, here is a project that comes well funded. Let's work with Google to give them our archive. So I think the hollowing out of the underfunded arts institution doesn't give them much way to move. And so as a result, as there's a desperation to mobilize the digital in order to see this tech startup money, or more recently in NFTs, there is a pressure to put one's critical thoughts aside and maybe annex the work you've been doing in order to collaborate with private funders and sponsors in that way. So I think that's why collaborative research was a great model for us, because it could be experimental, it was a bit under the radar. It didn't have to deliver a huge amount of footfall because it wasn't some big Google collaboration. And it was importantly funded by a trust and foundation, Esme Fairbanks. So I think it's very hard for galleries to maintain a distance, as I said, even as they're, on the one hand, they might be exhibiting Autonomy Cube by Trevor Paglen, even as they're harvesting data on the free Wi-Fi downstairs. So there is a kind of impossibility for the institution to maintain a kind of politics there, I think, in especially in British austerity and cultural policy.
I think there's also a really interesting thing that came out of Mo's presentation in relation to that, particularly about how, because some of these media are cheap, they're easy to access, it kind of draws people to them. And yet there's obviously a kind of a different type of relationship in terms of both the kind of the supply chain relationship and the kind of the way in which these things lead to different types of cultures of consumption. And I'm quite curious, we'll get more of that, I think, later today from our next two presentations as well. But I'm quite curious about this relationship and the tension between the origins of some of these media. So Mo, you mentioned that slide tape kind of was very widely used within educational settings and had this sort of relationship to a different type of consumption before it sort of got adopted by artists. And I think I'm quite curious about that relationship that comes out of what a media might have been used for and intended for, and how it's been transformed by bringing it into this other context, this kind of art context, which sort of holds it up outside of, attempts to hold it up outside of a kind of a broader, a sort of more sort of general cultural space. This idea that institutions try and create a hierarchy there, exactly as Liz is sort of establishing.
Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, the standard art history lecture at the kind of time that I was describing used slide transparencies of artworks. So everybody was very familiar with that kind of technology at that point. And then I see the same kinds of things happening with my own students now, who are using the Facebook and so on, and using Instagram, and that this is where they're putting their artworks, but they're doing that quite uncritically, as you've pointed out, Katrina. And that's become a very popular medium. The other thing is that you mustn't forget, I don't think, is that while particularly younger undergraduate students, particularly in those early years, they haven't accumulated those critical faculties yet. So they're accessing popular medias in much the same way as everybody else.
We have a question in the chat that's come in from Lewis Allenby, who says, I'm currently a third year BA fine art student. My course has finally started doing photography workshops in the photography department, and I joined this academic year as I didn't get this until this year. I've had a keen interest since first year, obsessed with the darkroom, doing my dissertation on camera versus cameraless photography and abstract photography. So I've really appreciated this talk. Any advice, research on what's out there in the real world, so to speak? I'm having to teach myself, really.
Okay, what does he mean by cameraless photography?
I can only go with what's written in
cameraless photography is alternative photographic processes.
Yeah, usually. Yeah. Yes, yeah. So he's using the sun or using light in other sort of way. Yeah.
I'm going to interpret the question in relation to trying to make sense of, oh, here we go.
He says photograms, pinhole photography, etc.
Oh, okay. Oh, you were on a roll there. Maybe you want to...
He's looking for resources. Is that what the question was?
I think looking for advice about real world experience. So how to, what you can do outside of the halls of academia.
Ah, yes. Well, there's the London Alternative Photography Collective. So you should definitely hang out with them. Oh, and Rowan's pointed to the Sustainable Darkroom Project in the chat. So.
Okay. Yes, perhaps other people are more aware of these things than I am. Based out in the East Midlands.
and but, while you're at it, Lewis, you should read Sluis's Philosophy of Photography. That's my advice.
Fantastic. Thank you both so much. This has been great, and it's been really wonderful to kind of unpick some of the ideas that you sort of touched upon in your presentations. We're going to take a short break now, and we will be back at 11:35. We're taking a break now. That's the time now. And we'll be back at 11:50 with presentations by Rowan Lear and Peter Lyde. See you all shortly. Hello, everyone. I'm going to give it another couple of minutes, and then we can start with our second half of the panel. Okay, let's get going. Welcome back. To kick off the second half of this morning's session, let me introduce our next two speakers. Dr. Rowan Lear is an artist and a doctoral researcher in photographic history and theory at the University of West London, under the supervision of Professors Michelle Henning and Helen Hester. Informed by feminist, new materialist, post-humanist and process philosophies, their thesis argues that photography has constituted a new kind of body. Rowan has delivered research papers at leading photography conferences in Europe and has conducted research in archives and collections in the UK and North America. In 2018-19, Rowan organised Planetary Processing, a peer forum for experimental photographic artists at the Photographers Gallery. Following the presentation from Rowan, we'll have a presentation from Dr. Peter Ride, who is the course leader for the Masters in Museums, Galleries and Contemporary Culture at the University of Westminster. He has worked in a wide range of arts organisations, including the National Museum of Photography, Film and TV, the Photographers Gallery, Cambridge Darkroom Gallery, the Arts Technology Centre, ARTEC, in London, and DA2, Digital Arts Development Agency. He is the co-author with Professor Andrew Judney of the New Media Handbook, published by Routledge in 2006, and the Digital Media Handbook, published by Routledge in 2013. And he has published widely on new media projects in museums and galleries. So I'm gonna hand over to Rowan, if I could ask Rowan to join us on with her camera on. And then we'll, once Rowan's done, if Peter could. Thanks very much.
Okay, just gonna wait for, some slides, great. Hi everyone, good morning.
Sorry, shall I start the video now, Rowan?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Thank you.
The video's just gonna run in the background. Okay. The summer of 1976 was a hot, sticky affair. To escape the heat wave, British day trippers swarmed to the beaches, taking their cameras with them. Over the summer, retailers experienced such high demand for photographic equipment that Kodak was not able to fulfill their orders. Meanwhile, freshly exposed films began to flood in through the mail to photo processing factories around the country, including one in northwest London. Here, 400 workers and their machines operated long shifts in a photochemical haze, processing, developing, printing, sorting, and packing thousands of snapshots daily, in a building without a working cooling system. Perhaps the weather contributed to what the company director would later dismiss as bad feelings that summer. When the mostly female East African, Asian and Afro-Caribbean workforce walked out of Brunswick Processing Laboratories Limited, they triggered one of the most significant labor disputes in British history. Today, Brunswick is celebrated for its displays of mass solidarity that spanned race, gender and industry, and lamented for its failure to attain union recognition or reinstatement for the striking workers and the union breaking that was to swiftly follow. The dispute has been studied in histories of labor organizing, trade unions and immigration, but there has been little discussion around its implications for the history and theory of photography. Borrowing a phrase uttered by strike organizer Jayabin Desai, this paper argues that what Brunswick brings to our attention is the honey on the elbow. You can smell it, you can feel it, but you can't see it. The honey on the elbow here is the residue of networks that comprise photocapitalism, a sticky web which bind weather to workplace, consumer to worker, machine to empire. So this paper is extracted from a more extensive discussion in my doctoral thesis, where a full account of the Brunswick disputes and working conditions inside the factory can be found. Today, I will follow the theme of this conference to attend specifically to what Brunswick reveals of the networks and infrastructures of mass film processing an industry which peaked in the 1970s and 80s. I'm going to outline just two particular networks critical to the photo finishing sector in this period, and consequently to the unfolding dispute. And those are the harnessing of the National Postal Service and the phenomena of free film, and secondly, workforce recomposition following the collapse of British occupation and anti-colonial resistance around the world. In 1968, as a young company, Grunwick boldly changed their business model. Rather than rely on business from chemists and retailers, the company reoriented to target photographic consumers directly. Grunwick consulted a female marketing director in America to develop a mass mailing drive. As director George Ward noted, the format of the envelopes are improved by stressing feminine colors, pastels like pink and lavender, to appeal to the housewife. Grunwick's target customer was the home worker or second shifter, a working or lower middle class woman. Unlike the amateur hobbyists who prowled the photographic departments of Boots and other retailers, this customer was time poor and managed a smaller household budget. Grunwick initiated their first direct mail campaign in 1968, supplying 2 million households with prepared and prepaid envelopes in which to seal their exposed films and return. The mail order strategy was not based simply on low price and high convenience. Grunwick also began to offer an expedited service, promising to return films in 4 or 5 days, much faster than the industry standards of 10 to 21 days, an impulse that contributed to speed up in the factory. The deployment of mail ordering, along with the demand created by new low-cost cameras like the Instamatic, led to growing competition between photo finishing companies. Each needed to attract and retain a base of customers making regular orders. This instigated a widespread free film market. As an industry analyst described in 1972, whether they come fluttering down as garish envelopes on the doormat or appear as premiums on biscuit packets or mustard pots, the principle is the same. Send your color snaps to us for processing and we will send you your free film in return. The free film phenomenon was a symptom of an industry in transformation. Technical advances and increased capital expenditure on film processing machinery put pressure on companies to keep their production lines busy, and free films generated a logic of return, invested in the consumer and their desire to photograph. With their own free film called Bonus Pool, mass mailing became the primary apparatus by which Grunwick put them in the hands of consumers. The fingers of busy home photographers met the fingers of busy photo finishers through the sorting apparatus of the National Postal Service. Consequently, the blacking of Grunwick's mail was one of the most significant actions of the industrial dispute. Over 4 days in 1976 and 7 weeks in 1977, postal workers refused to handle the company's mail. In both periods of blacking, the post office stopped making deliveries in the neighborhood. Workers refused to collect Grunwick's mail and redirected incoming posts via sorting centres elsewhere in the UK, creating a slowdown effect. 3 weeks after the 1977 postal blacking began, there were nearly 1,000 mailbags containing about 100,000 packets of processed mail piling up in every available corner in the Chapter Road works. 84% of Grunwick's trade depended on mail order, and this pile represented about £1.5 million in today's money. The company's vulnerability led George Ward to repeatedly describe the blacking as a threat to our jugular. The mail network was not the only vital system targeted by the strike. Drivers at British Oxygen refused to make deliveries, and Heathrow Airport workers blacked Grunwick shipments, forcing the company to alter its export trade routes. Small pickets were set up outside several pharmacies that sent film processing work to Grunwick, and Kodak workers themselves threatened Grunwick with blacking, at a time when the company was spending about £2 million per year with Kodak. Grunwick's business model relied on mail order and national supply chains of goods and services, revealing the highly networked character of the photographic industry at this time, a phenomena that Henri Van Leer described in 1983 as planetary processing. Critically, these networks were both a source of the company's success and its site of vulnerability. As suggested earlier, the fluctuation of seasonality posed a continual problem for photo finishing companies as well as photographic retailers, with peaks and troughs over the year. However, the development of British capitalism had long attempted to soften the blow of fluctuation through flows of internal and external migrant labour. As Stephen Andan describes, migrant labour, precisely because it was migrant, seasonal and contractual, filling in the labour gaps in times of expansion and being fired in times of recession, served to absorb the shocks of alternating booms and depressions. In the 1960s, over a dozen African countries gained independence from British rule. The racial tensions built and exploited by colonial administrations unsettled the status of newer arrivals. As a result, British subjects from South Asia living in African countries faced enormous uncertainty, if not outright expulsion, and many travelled to build new lives in the UK. As the empire retreated territorially, it re-territorialized the people it had displaced under it. Faced with the movement of people from former colonies, successive interventions by the British government worked to pass legislation in 1962, 68, and 69, which tightened the definition of citizenship, creating a renewed racialized hierarchy. Some were granted the right to work in Britain, but under circumstances that exposed them to institutional and overt racism, and by limiting full citizenship, rendered them vulnerable to expulsion. These were the circumstances under which the Grunwick workers had moved to the UK. In their previous settled lives in Tanzania, Uganda, and Kenya, many of Grunwick's women workers would have been part of an urban middle class, living in relatively affluent households and engaged in low-wage piecework at home, such as sewing. Jayabin Desai began to work for Grunwick in 1974 and observed the rapid transformation of the workforce. The recruitment of new immigrants was a deliberate campaign. She says, "They got more work out of us. Asians had just come from Uganda and they all needed work, so they took whatever was available. Grunwick put out papers, 'Come and we will give you a job. We give jobs to everyone, door to door.' When I went, a friend of mine followed, and soon they were full of our people." Within a few years, Grunwick staff changed from being majority white, female, and working class Britons to immigrant female and of East African, Asian, or Afro-Caribbean heritage. However, those newly settled in Britain developed strong communal bonds and brought together with them with high expectations of their rights as workers and as British citizens. Lakshmi Patel, a former Grunwick employee and member of the strike committee, reported that the strike came about because our women were treated badly. "We believed that if women had so many rights in this country, then why can't we have them too?" All in all, the state had achieved for capital the best combination of factors for the exploitation of labour, while appearing at the same time to have barricaded the nation against the intrusion of an alien wedge. This toxic milieu informed Grunwick's recruitment strategy, which was, as Anita writes, to hire workers who exhibited all the classic characteristics of cheap labour, readily available, that cost little or nothing to recruit, that was willing to accept low hourly and weekly wages, that offered flexibility in terms of hours, overtime, and seasonal demand, and that was assumed to be docile and therefore unlikely to resist continuous efforts to increase their productivity. Interviews with workers also reveal a racial division of labour within Grunwick, a separation between the upstairs mailroom, which was populated with South Asian women, and downstairs in a processing room, where women of Afro-Caribbean origin worked. The structural division, entailing different shifts and rates of pay, helped to ensure a racial hierarchy, weaker communication between workers, and prevent coordinated resistance. This is reflected in Desai's observation that it was several days before Black workers in the film processing department learned about the ongoing action and joined the strike. The strategic fragmentation of the workforce was common among British companies, meaning workers' revolts took a certain character. Resistance to racial abuse and discrimination on the shop floor was more spontaneous than organized. Some workers left their jobs and went and found other work. Others just downed tools and walked away. Against the backdrop of a pervasive anti-immigration rhetoric, unions remained suspicious or hostile to organizing by immigrant workers. The widespread trade union backing of the Grunwick strikers, though ultimately defeated, marked a radical shift in that tendency. British colonial conquest annihilated people's social and cultural networks and relationships. As Nadine El-Nenani writes, colonialism involves the theft of intangibles such as economic growth and prospects, opportunities, life chances, psyches, and futures. Colonial migration networks worked in Grunwick's favour, enabling low pay and abuses of power on the factory floor. At the same time, the new networks and solidarities formed between immigrant and Indigenous workers unsettled the white supremacist structures of British life. So what I have described are two of a multitude of flows that converge at Grunwick, a flow of workers and a flow of goods. But these are not the smooth flows imagined by capital. In sunny weather, photographic films fill the post. Over winter, they dwindle. At the border, people are blocked, interrupted, and filtered. In the factory, workers go slow. Down tools, stop work. At the gates, strikers swell to prevent entry, and the police develop violent tactics to remove them. The flows of this network are viscous, perpetually stopping, starting, resisting, reconnecting, getting stuck. The sticky network of labour and logistics revealed at Grunwick demonstrates how thoroughly British photographic production is and was entangled with colonial and capitalist imperatives, beyond and in fact prior to any representation proffered by the processed and printed photographic image. Donna Haraway suggests that networking is both a feminist practice and a multinational corporate strategy. If we learn how to read these webs of power and social life, we might learn new couplings, new coalitions. Studying the embodied and perpetually leaking networks of photography makes tangible a web of connections and possibilities for solidarity, where the forced smiles of those in front of the camera meet the gritted teeth of those who hold the picket line. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rowan, for that absolutely beautiful presentation. And now let me hand over to Peter. Thank you.
Hi, thanks, Maitreyi. Okay, I'm just going to share screen. Okay, can you just confirm that's up and running?
That's great, Peter, thank you.
Okay, fine, thanks, and hello, everybody. It's great to see such a fantastic group of people here today. So a quick word of explanation, because of technical reasons, this is a talk through a PowerPoint rather than a reading of a written paper. So today what I wanted to look at was a moment in time when the independent photography gallery sector started to embrace new media practice. And I want to talk in particular, I'm going to start off with a little case study, which is a project called Art Aids that ran from the early 90s through to the late 90s, and which was in essence a collaborative online arts project. But I'm doing this as a case study because I want to think about the precedents which were set by it and the lessons which we can learn from it. Okay, today, for those of you who don't know, is the 1st of December. Well, you all know that. But today is World AIDS Day. And World AIDS Day started up in the late 1980s and emanated from New York, and particularly with a group called Visual AIDS, which led on it. And in 1989, they organized the first Day Without Art, where art galleries around, well, particularly in New York and around the States, started to take an action, a political action, because of the appalling government actions in places like the US, but also in the UK as well, towards supporting developing medical treatment. You know, a lot of these things ring very true with what's been going on over the last year with artists and cultural groups taking action. So Day Without Art was operating in New York, but there was actually, despite quite a lot of activity around AIDS as a health need and as a social need in the UK at the time, there actually wasn't a lot which was going on as kind of culturally organized things. I was then working at the Photographers Gallery, and Sue Davies was then the director and replaced in 19, 1991 by Sue Grayson Ford. And we discussed what we should do as a way of taking part with this general social movement. And one of the things that we decided we could do within a limited form was to take part in A Day Without Art, which involved things like, for example, shrouding pictures within the walls rather than closing the gallery. But then we also started to ask, what could we possibly do which would take on board other kind of actions? Could we actually do things that would lead us to other kind of projects? Could we do things which were more photographic? For example, do things like a photographic quilt. The AIDS quilt was something which had been developed at that time. Could we do something which actually, it seems a little bit ludicrous now, but we talked about it very seriously, which was a way of gathering people together and actually faxing photographs as a way of creating a chain of photographs which could go around the country and work in particular with the galleries which saw themselves as the independent photography galleries. And so this was something that we were exploring as a possibility. At the same time, we were working on more conventional photographic approaches. I was involved with a group, the Photographers Gallery was involved with a group with Steve Mays, the network agency and the Terence Higgins Trust to develop a photo documentary project, which was called Positive Lives. And that finally was published as a book and it was premiered as an exhibition at the Photographers Gallery and at kind of Photofesh in Glasgow. Another thing which was really significant, which that at that moment, which was that Tim Berners-Lee invented the World Wide Web. And by the early 90s, this became a kind of a possibility for people to actually work with images in a shared online space, which was a hugely radical concept. And Netscape released the first web browser in 1994, which made possible the idea that we didn't fax photographs from one person to another or one organization to another, but actually photographs could be uploaded and held in a jointly accessible shared space. Again, as I say, these ideas were, which seem so banal now, were extraordinarily radical and game-changing in the 90s. So what happened with the project was that Art AIDS became known as a project where, and I was then at that point working at the Photographers Gallery in the print room, to be developed as a collaborative public engagement project, which could involve anybody who wanted to take part in it. We held a number of activities. We held an international art gathering, working with UCL, University College London, who had what was essential and very few people had, the Super Janet Broadband Network and what was then called the M-Bone, which was a high data transmission route between academic organizations. And remember, this is the time when a lot of households didn't actually have telephone lines, let alone have anything that had the technical capacity to carry a signal. We also worked with an AIDS charity, Crusade, Queen Mary College, and the BBC Networking Club. There are a number of actors that were all incredibly interested in saying, how can we harness the work of new technology? And there were people who were coming together with a political purpose. And as was discussed at the previous session of this conference, the 1980s and the 1990s were a time of extreme opposition to conservative government that had been in rule for a long period of time and ruthlessly suppressing all kinds of things like social, political, kind of sexual action through things like Clause 28. So there were reasons for people who were involved in the cultural and the academic sector to band together to be involved in projects which were not just about the development of the image and the way that we could see that or the development of technology and where that could go to, but the way in which politics had a very social function. So the Art AIDS project began as an internet art project. It started off with 20 artists who contributed, in essence, their work, some things being made specifically for the project and some being work which already existed, which they wanted to contribute. Because, of course, technological access was an issue. The number of people who could participate was really relatively limited. And because there was no easy access for images to become shared, it was FTP file uploads, which was relatively a complicated kind of process. So we recognized that what needed to be done was a series of workshops which could take place with photographic galleries to bring communities of people together who had a like-minded interest who might want to take part. So the way we described it at the time was that this was a chain of images, that it played with the notion of the virus, that it played with the idea of modification and regeneration of the virus, but doing something in a positive way. And again, I only have to look back at the things which I've been involved in and a lot of my colleagues have been involved in over the last year and a half to see the same language that's happened around coronavirus that was happening around AIDS. Also, another thing that was really important was the idea that an art project could be a collective activity which enabled people to contribute, and people who wanted to play a part within the kind of the cultural and social discourse around a disease or around sort of the social effects of the disease, whether or not it was directly affecting them and their immediate circle of friends. But that idea of being involved was absolutely crucial. And the idea, as we said in the original text, we are all involved, was absolutely kind of important for the logic of a project like this. And to just give you an idea of some of the images that came through and how we were operating. This is an image contributed by an artist, Alistair Raphael, an image of an empty bed, an image by an artist, Jane Prophet, of the heart and where the heart is the seat of blood, but also symbolically the idea of love and its relationship to the body. But then through the workshop process that took place and the online contribution of images, these sorts of things happened. Now I look at this and it is, I could go now, you know, a four-year-old could do this now on their phone. But actually in the early 90s, the idea of someone taking an image of a bed, creating a quilt to put on the bed, and then quilting hearts on the bed, which was playing with the metaphor as well as obviously what was happening with Photoshop, was just actually quite staggering. And it fulfilled so many of the needs of the image because it was seeing that an image could be taken from one thing, being developed into another. The idea of the authorial kind of relationships between the different images was being kind of questioned. Lots of stuff which was happening through this kind of image making was creating a dialogue about how we exchange what we own, what we do, what intellectual property is, though I don't think I would have used those words then. And also it shows to me one of the things which also now working on a huge number of socially engaged and community participation projects, these in a sense become the standard way of operating and a little bit becomes really important and significant. So just a little bit more on the project. So one of the other things that made this project interesting was that at its time, it was probably the first internet-based art project in the UK. We then went to the Arts Council and the Photography Panel for funding and received funding to develop it as a photographic project. And I was then working at the Cambridge Darkroom Gallery. So it was being hosted then. And so it then became the first project funded through the Arts Council as an internet art project. And it went on with a number of commissions, worked with a number of galleries, photographic galleries around the country. We held workshops in many of those galleries, either on Art AIDS, on World AIDS Day or at other times of the year when people would come in, but also kind of at other points. And the work was shown within the gallery context. And I'll speak about this a little bit more later. And we worked with international collaborators. So this was with the International Arts Group based out of Toronto General Idea, where they were reworking a piece which was recently on show in Tate, Britain. And this was in collaboration with an American organization called ArtaWeb. So what can we learn from a case study like this? Well, we can see from this the number of changes that were taking place in the sector. And there was also a growing need to respond to a cultural moment and a determination to get on board with innovation. And so why actually was that happening with the photography galleries? I think also what we see here, which is important, we see there's a shift in the way that the galleries thought about their relationship with audiences. and also by reflecting, there is a value at looking back at earlier new media projects to see not only how they operated and what they were trying to do, but the way in which they operated within a broader context or a kind of an ecology of arts practice at the time. So let's take a second and think about what was happening with the independent photography galleries in the 80s and 90s. In a way, you know, and this has been talked about by many other people, so I won't go into this at great detail, but the independent photography sector had a really important significance, partly because they produced photography around the country, and there was a substantial number of photography galleries. But they were mission driven. They really had a clear purpose, which was to enable and to support practitioners and to support a language and a discourse around photography and present it within a cultural context. All the things that led to the development of the Photographers' Gallery in 1971 were the things which led over the kind of the next 10 years to a number of spaces starting up around the country. But essentially as well, unlike the Photographers' Gallery, they operated at the fringes. Very much at the fringe of the art world, and excluded for a lot of the conversations that were taking place within what we've now called visual culture. They combined practice communities and art communities. Literally, a lot of these spaces had dark rooms. So there were people who were coming in who were making work, as well as people who were interested in the discourse around photographic practice, and sometimes more broadly within photographic practice and its relationship to wider practices. But the idea that photography offered something that was special was really important. I think it has to be said that the precarious finances for these organizations, it was a really important point. We would do anything at the smell of an oily rag. It was extraordinary what was going on with very, very small budgets. So there was incredible capability for people to be inventive with the resources available to them. There's also a quest for recognition and what we could now describe as kind of a slice for the audience's attention and for recognition that photography was important. The other thing that needs to be said was there was a very strong set of networked relationships and touring networks, which were funded directly by the Arts Council or little bits of seed funding from the Arts Council to enable touring shows. So basically, people talked with each other and there was an incredibly strong sense of camaraderie-ness. This is really important when you think about what happens with new technology. Visual arts really had no particular interest in the visual arts sector in new technology and what it offered. There'd been an exhibition at the ICA in the late 60s, which looked at digital aesthetics and electronic art. But in some ways, the discussions about that really hadn't gone a lot further than that. There was a sense that computer arts was sat within academic resources, computer science departments. It was being taken up by people interested in music and performance and obviously people exploring the ideas of coding, but it really wasn't crossing through into a broader sector. Video-based art, performance installation were the kind of things that the visual arts sector was more concerned with and more interested in embracing. And I would say, however, as well, it's kind of, I wouldn't say that the photography sector embraced wholeheartedly new technologies at all. There was a considerable degree of caution. There was a considerable fear that a lot of the arguments and discussions about photography had moved beyond materials and tools and techniques and gone into visual art practices and theory, and working with technology was taking it back again. But also communities of practice and practitioners meant that people weren't always interested in what was happening as the new. But universities were incredibly important as places which were generating discussion, critical practice and work. And one of the things about the photography sector is that it did work closely with universities and schools of art. And also schools of art had access to resources which were really important. And around the country, there was a sense of there being multiple hubs and spokes, that there were networks, not just the ones I sort of spoke about, the photographic networks, but all those galleries had their own networks, all of which mattered. And of course, the big game changers for new media is the release of Photoshop, the release of Director, which happened in the 1990s and put sophisticated programming into the hands of students and academics and arts practitioners. And I'd also emphasize that, of course, the photography gallery wasn't the only place that was interested in this. There was video time-based arts interested, festivals that were supporting staff. There were many different things going on. But as one of the artists I was interviewing, in advance of this presentation said to me, the festivals had the budgets, video had the resources, but photography galleries had spaces and audiences, and that was really important. So when we think about the shift of the photography sector, I can sort of say, well, why is it worthy of consideration? And, you know, what did it offer people who were challenging and thinking about the idea of the photographic image? These set things we can see being explored through practice from those very early days, from things like the Art Aids Project, how discussions that lead to things that Katrina's been talking about with the digital wall and centers for reconsidering what the photographic image is now within digital culture has importance, but also this major institutional impact that went on as well. One of the people I spoke to, a former curator at the Camera Works, said, I wondered if new media with the nail in the coffin of the independent photography sector, because pretty much it had imploded within 10 years of this period of time. And I would say that necessarily wasn't, but I think there are a number of factors going on. And if I've got time, do I have time to continue for about another 3 minutes?
That should be fine.
Okay, great. So I want to look at some work which is generated by galleries like Zone, Camera Work Site, Impressions, Focal Point, and to think about the physical reality and the resources that went on here. One of the things that needs to be said, of course, was I said about the galleries having spaces. The galleries had the space to create exhibitions, but an exhibition could sometimes be putting a CD-ROM on display. It could be creating an exhibition of digital photography on the walls in a conventional way, but it could also be showing online things. Galleries also, photographic galleries also had a very good tradition of commissioning work. And supporting through other means. And supporting through other means could mean lending a laptop or, you know, lending a modem so someone could do something. But also the photographic galleries became very good at interdisciplinary collaborations, recognizing that going across art forms was enabled through digital materiality, but also was socially possible and it made things happen. And there was a strong alignment with academia and with industry. So people who were working, for example, in games industries, starting to work with artists working collectively to produce work. I talked about networking, but networking was also important internationally as well as nationally. And all the things we understand now, the very fact we weren't talking about the physical transport of work meant that networks could be very effective in terms of collaborative generation of work. So collaboration became a consistent mode of practice. And that's really important as a change of operation with the photography galleries, which in most places was primarily about a solo artist producing work, and then it was put on the walls. So collaborative teams working together and all the risks that involves and all the creative challenges became important. But what's hugely significant is the way that the gallery provides a context. The gallery provided the link to a discourse around media practice in all its forms. And in a sense, what's happening, I think we can say, is that the photography galleries were curating a moment, a way that things could be shown. And just some examples, for example, and some of these may seem really banal. A very early project by Nancy Honey, who is already established as a photographer, particularly working on women's issues and images around family. This is an interactive project that she did, seen as a CD-ROM, rolling on over those photographs brings more detail about the women whose images they are and their histories. Anti-ROM was exhibited at Camera Work Gallery. It was a CD-ROM. And they created events around it. The artists who were then working at University of Westminster were really interested in challenging kind of what a digital navigation was and what a ROM structure was. Susan Collins at Zone Gallery, interested in motion detection and using this to trigger images. Jane Prophet and Gordon Selly developing an early AI project, which was using a game's format, but creating a world, a fictitious world where people could upload content, behavioral characteristics to animals that would then live within that world. Paul Sermon's project, Telematic Dreaming, here being seen live between Camera Work in London and Zone Gallery in Newcastle. So, essentially what we're doing now, early video conferencing. And just on that line, the slightly later project by Susan Collins, which takes us absolutely back into the realm of the photographic, a shared project between Site Gallery in Sheffield and a Newland Art Gallery in Cornwall, where a photographic image of a landscape is being built up pixel by pixel, 1 pixel per second. So it's a durational image, and that's being seen, an image, a landscape image of Cornwall is being seen in Sheffield and vice versa. And Skies, the name of the show was Transporting Skies. The sky of Sheffield was being seen in Newland and vice versa. So, you know, in a sense, early video conferencing, but absolutely challenging the idea of what the image is and how we can understand it. And I put this image in because this is from Zone Gallery, a really typical idea of what was going on, that whether someone was, I'm not sure what the headset is this person's wearing, but, you know, at the back of the office, you see a computer that was probably being used at other times to do email, being brought out for the exhibition purposes on a relatively makeshift desk. This is exactly the kind of thing that was happening. So within these projects, there's an idea about what the materiality is of the photograph, the idea of the authorial experience, the idea of the authentic experience, the idea that the interface is a surface that can be worked with, that code is a kind of a choreography that we can work with, thinking about what the site is of the gallery and where the photograph is actually sited. Is the photograph actually sited in space? Is it the photograph, or is the image sited somewhere else? And interactivity. I can't go through this presentation without mentioning interactivity. As one of the artists I spoke to said, well, was it a holy grail or was it a cul-de-sac? Because it was talked about in the 90s as a holy grail. But interactivity is really important because if we think about it from a 2021 perspective, where the discourse is hugely around within the gallery and museum sector around participation and social engagement, it's a necessary way of getting there. It's a shift in the understanding of curation and what it is from the passive consumer of the image or of the art experience to the active experience, to the user-generated content. And what the curator and the gallery was doing was designing opportunities for people to be engaged. So all these things lead us to the conversations about representation, how we understand it kind of photographically, but not just, and Katrina was alluding to this, not just identity-based issues of representation that photography was so big on, but the underlying issues about what are the structures and the industries that propel the representational media. You know, all the things that lead us to think about post-photography and post-truth, languages we weren't using then, but they are thinking about power structures, who owns the software, what is the data, big brother notions about observation. So all the early conversations about art and science were really important here, and the ideas that there are new languages, new territories, which are militarized, which are highly gendered, which are highly racialized, and that artists can provide and galleries can provide a space to actually insert and have a dialogue about that. So kind of very rapidly to wind this up. So the Arts Council, supported through the network of photography galleries, established something called Channel, which by the time that I had left Cambridge Darkroom Gallery and was working at Artec, I was responsible for supervising, which was trying to create an alternative online gallery space. Didn't work completely, but generated a number of projects which were interesting and showed very much the direction that things were going on. So between 97 and about kind of, you know, 2000 and well, around 2000, Channel was operating very effectively with a huge number of these galleries. But doing things like, for example, this is Forced Entertainment, a well-known performance kind of theater group, they may describe themselves as, based out of Sheffield at that time, creating a city space that people could inhabit and place their stories within the space. Heath Bunting doing a project with Folly Gallery, with Sight Gallery and Folly Gallery, hacking into police CCTV cameras and enabling people to report fictitious crimes, which would then be sent through to the fax lines of the police and then keep them busy. So a little bit of kind of, you know, urban mischief making going on there by Heath Bunting, which is very much part of the kind of a way of operating things. So when I think about it overall and reflecting back on it, what do I say? Well, I'd say in lots of ways that these projects and the way the independent photography galleries were operating were really trying to support and further photography's legacy, or the way they saw their role in photography's legacy, challenging the medium as a communications device, interrogating how it's used for making meaning, thinking very much about creative practice as a tool for social engagement, going beyond the gallery, which in lots of ways I'd say had previously been limited to a notion of community arts, which was very kind of excluded from main gallery practice, and definitely expanding the audience experience. And one of the museum curators I work with often says that the museum is the place where humanity meets the hardware. And I would say in my conclusion here that the gallery, the photographic gallery, became the meeting place where humanity meets the software. And I'm just going to end on a World AIDS Day image from the ArtAIDS project. So thank you. And I do apologize for that excessive use of time.
Thank you so much, Peter. That was a tour de force history of 30 years of independent art galleries, of photography galleries. Thank you so much for running through that so concisely, and lots and lots of questions. Could I ask Rowan to rejoin us, and we'll do a short Q&A with the two of you, and then I'll invite our earlier speakers, Mo and Katrina, to rejoin, and we'll have a kind of a broader panel discussion of some of the kind of key themes that come through all of the presentations we've heard this morning. I want to start, there was a lot of chat already around Rowan, your presentation, but I'll come to that in a minute. I think one of the things that I pulled out as a sort of really interesting parallel between both of your presentations was the importance of networks, that the image and photographic technology has been the nexus to explore questions of inclusion and exclusion. The Gronwick process coalesced around a supply chain network, focused around ambitions of turning a technology into a mass consumable leisure pursuit, and it was a coalition of perhaps labor forces who were excluded from that consumption, and that as a means of production. And on the flip side, you have the networks of independent photography galleries who were excluded from a mainstream visual cultural discourse or art world discourse, but nevertheless were producers who could then take some control over the means of production. And I'm really curious to kind of explore more about what these inclusions and exclusions have allowed for, how the photographic medium and the discipline and the technologies allow in themselves a form of activism, both around the medium and within the medium. Rowan, I don't know if you want to start, and then I'll hand over to Peter.
Yeah, great. Yeah, thank you for the comment and question. I guess I'm not super sure how to answer, but I guess my real interest in exploring Gronwick is in the workers and the people who are, like I, in my thesis, I'll say I describe them as photographing bodies. So that will include the people who are taking pictures at the beach during the heat wave, but will also include the people who are working in the factory to process those films. So I think there's a way of being trying to think about photography where you start to try and look at all these aspects, all these ways that people are entangled in the networks of photographic production. And that is not necessarily the traditional photographer with a camera perspective. So there's a lot of different kind of perspectives in that process. So I say, like elsewhere, I've looked at the impact of pollution from the photographic industry and how that's affected people in a kind of spatial and temporal displacement from maybe the place where the photograph is actually taken. Also my interest is in forms of resistance as well. I think I'm quite quite concretely not so concerned with representation as forms of resistance. It's just maybe not where I'm looking, and I think that's reflected also in my presentation, where I wasn't so concerned to show pictures of Gronwick. They're very easily found. Gronwick is quite a spectacle. Give it a Google, you see the pictures. I was kind of interested in this metaphor that Desai spoke about, the honey on the elbow, something that you can't see. And I was thinking about, so what is it that we can't see when we look at these pictures at the strike of Gronwick and the kind of all the spectacle of it what are the things we're not noticing or not seeing? And I have to say, one of the things that's quite hard to get any pictures of is what actually the inside of the factory looked like. There's a little bit, but not very much. So it's listening to people's kind of own narratives and descriptions of their working conditions, their working lives, as well as, you know, these narratives are all competing as well. The narrative of the company director, who has a very different take on it. And you're kind of reading between the lines of what people are saying. I'd say that's kind of my concern and my interest at the moment.
Peter, do you want to say anything about sort of this idea of the kind of inclusion, exclusion, and the role of the image in that kind of activist space?
Yeah, I'd like to. And I think I've got to say, Maitreyi, I thought you joined our two presentations together perfectly, because on one hand, it seems like they don't sit beside each other that easily, but actually I think they do. And I think there's something fascinating and interesting, of course, you know, before the idea of new media and the way in which the sort of the era that I was talking about, of course, the huge thrust within the independent photography sector was social documentary practice. It was oppositional practice. One of the key tenet was that photography was being used to explore the things, and the independent photography sector was being used to show an alternative understanding of what was happening. It was absolutely not about fine arts practice. It the generation of places like the Photographers Gallery and those galleries were utterly about saying, how do we give voice? How do we represent the kind of things that were going on? And some galleries more than others, of course, were really interested. Side in Newcastle, for example, absolutely interested within the tradition of kind of black and white documentary journalism, photojournalism, about, you know, looking at a disposition and social groups who are otherwise excluded. You know, and there are questions and problematic issues which we can ask about this, you know, people from art schools kind of looking at people who didn't have resources. But those things align themselves immediately to the kind of things which were being brought up by new media practice, which we now call digital poverty and access. Who has access to resources? Who has power over those images? And the kind of things that Katrina was talking about earlier. What happens to your images, your intellectual property? What is Gmail doing to the things that you write? Why does Alexa know that when I've talked about something that it then offers me something to buy? All those kinds of things, which are about our relationship to a kind of a larger structure, how we operate within it. Those are all the things which are being kicked out. And I think the thing about exclusion, about, because it's not just about who doesn't have access to resources. It's much bigger than that. It's actually about how the powers that control the resources work with the people within the systems. I think the Grundwick example is absolutely fascinating. And one of the things as well, which photography was sometimes good at talking about and sometimes not good at talking about, was that we can talk about photographic process and we can talk about materiality, but the people who are involved in making things was so important. The people who are involved in factory lines producing images, and we'd now also talk about industrial health, the conditions I would dread to look back and consider the kind of the lack of health and safety that I suspect probably existed on the lines of some like Grundwick, all the things that we now, and that racialized environment, those things are actually really important. I think they align together very, very well.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I mean, I think these questions of the deployment of the technology, but also the kind of the invisible impact of it, when we think about data today, and the invisibility of energy consumption around data, around how the digital image and the circulation of the digital image still produces these inequities, and as you say about digital poverty, is a really interesting kind of parallel to draw with the work that Rowan was talking about. Rowan, there's a couple of questions directed at you in the Q&A. One was, in your presentation, you referred to a writer on colonialism and the theft of intangibles. Could you tell us a bit more about that reference? And also, there was a lot of questions in the chat during your presentation around the way in which you used images in your presentation, the video that you shared with us. the question from Amano Tracy is, I understand that what you were saying to be more important than what you were showing, but without the visual prompt, it was not easy to follow. I wonder what the thinking was behind this mode of presentation, and maybe you've answered this question, but I'm still wondering. So do you want to kind of just expand a little bit more about that relationship to representation? And I suppose it, for me, it also touches upon this question of ownership of the image, who has the power to share and show.
Yeah, cool, thank you for those questions. Just on the writer is Nadine Elanani, and I'm just gonna put a link in the chat to the book. It's a book called Bordering Britain. I think the subtitle is Law, Race and the Empire. It's a really, really good book. I really recommend it. Kind of the history of British border making, empire making. And just really excellent, particularly if you're interested in abolition as well, thinking about borders and abolition. It's a great text. So yeah, I just popped that in the chat. I think that's gone to everyone. Yeah. It's a question. Oh, thanks, Shauna. The question about, I guess I'm pretty, I'm pretty like, you know, I think, I think you can maybe see why I had those images in that way. And like I said, I'm not interested in the spectacle, and I'm kind of not interested in repeating those images because they didn't relate directly to what I was kind of talking about. I take the point that it's nice to focus on an image. so perhaps one image might have been better, but I'm just kind of interested in, I think focus is quite of an interesting question as well, is like when something is or isn't in focus, and when you can see it and when it's tangible, and the things that we tend to focus on in thinking about photography, and the things that are out of focus. I think those are really important questions. Not saying I made any bold like maneuver in relation to that, but maybe that was part of my thinking. The question of ownership is also really important. This is being recorded. I don't own any images of Grunwick myself. A lot of them have been bought by stock image companies, and the ones that aren't, obviously they have copyright issues. So I think that's probably, I wouldn't say it was top of my mind, but I think that's also an issue in thinking about who now owns these images of these, the strikers and saris, as they were called.
One of the other things that's come up in the chat, in the Q&A is, and Peter, perhaps you might want to touch upon this as well. Today, members of the UCU are on strike for better conditions of employment in universities. How do you see the relationship between the cultural politics of the historical period, trade unionism, and resistance to a reactionary state? I feel like we are quite consciously aware of the cultural wars that we're riding through at the moment. Be very curious to get both of your thoughts on this.
From my point of view, there's a slight irony. So my university isn't taking part in the strike because we missed by 1% the threshold for our ballots to be recognised, which is, the tail end of Thatcher's anti-union legislation. We could say a lot about union and organised workforce now. I'll leave it at that.
Great. I was gonna say thanks, Andrew, for the question. I think obviously studying Grimwick is like completely fundamental to understanding the situation that we're in now. And I think things like secondary picketing, I think in particular, was kind of almost a direct response to Grunwick banning secondary picketing. And I think that's really affected how we use our kind of networks of solidarity, how we can display and show and be in solidarity with other workers. There's been some really nice work done comparing Grunwick with a more recent, I think, the Gate Gourmet dispute. It's a really good text. I'll find a link to put in the chat. Where they discuss the kind of differences between two labour disputes before and after a lot of the union breaking took place, and the kind of differences in how it has been celebrated and the effectiveness of the dispute as well. I've actually lost the question. I think it's disappeared to another part of the chat, but it was yeah, I think it's really fundamental, and I'm kind of interested. You know, there's something about dislocation from the dislocation of the photographic industry or the distribution of it, so that if you're a photographer, you might not think you're in solidarity or could be in solidarity with someone who maybe works at B&H Photo in America, where they had a large strike of Mexican migrant workers in previous kind of few years ago. You might not think you have an osmotic connection to like their struggle, but actually, like, if we think about photography differently, as I know Andrew's also asked us to forget photography as a single thing, like we can maybe start to trace those networks a little bit more tangibly and realize like there are people that we should be in solidarity with.
I think it's really interesting when we think about sort of the networked image, and I'd like to invite Katrina and Mo to rejoin us. We can have a sort of a broader conversation, but just thinking through this idea of the networked image, even though the power of unions as a sort of networked alliance of solidarity has sort of dissipated, and not just dissipated, it's been actively dismantled. We have other forms of solidarity that actually do coalesce around the image in some ways, about the circulation of an image and how it's networked and creates new forms of network. And I'm quite curious actually to bring Katrina into this, because so much of your presentation also touched upon this, and how the kinds of image circulation and the sort of removal of the image from I suppose more tangible modes of mediation or representation have allowed it to kind of form different types of community in and solidarity in spaces that you wouldn't ordinarily conceive of.
Absolutely. I've been thinking about this a lot recently in relation to the kind of shifting contexts of photographic circulation, and particularly the ecosystems and how the infrastructure of the web has really shifted, especially since, say, 2004, when Flickr appeared and really offered a possibility of what kinds of collectivities can emerge around like forms of image sharing. And there were some incredibly interesting political, stupid, throwaway, imagery that brought people together and formed new relationships around that. And I think, of course, Flickr was an interesting example because it was really the poster child of Web 2, open content, Creative Commons, tried not to be evil, and eventually got taken over by Yahoo, made no money, and now Smugbug has come in to save the day and return it to its original state, promising to only do advertising 1.0 and not sort of ad tech kind of extractive policies. But of course, you know, the huge amount of startup funding and corporate funding to keep that going is quite extraordinary, and the business models mean that even if you're trying to create a kind of community online, there are, you know, ultimately at the back end, there are extremely extractive processes, to the point where now I'm quite fascinated with the example of a photo platform called I Am, which was a competitor to Instagram, going, come here, authentic photographers, we will have you. Go, you don't need to be in the botland of Instagram. But then they ultimately pivoted into a stock photography company as a political statement, because they refused to work with the ad tech model of Instagram. Now, and then they pivoted into an AI company where photographers are basically training their machines in aesthetics. So it's very hard to understand a kind of politics of the networked image, because it's like an iceberg. You can like look at it from one point, but there's all this other stuff beneath the surface. And what seems to be politically liberatory in the circulation of a certain kind of image, you know, ends up I don't know, being scraped into the Flickr data set, which was then scraped by IBM, and oppressing minorities in China through facial recognition the next day. So it's really quite difficult to begin to think where the politics of representation have gone in this quite complex stack, the photographic stack, I guess you might want to call it.
That actually leads us very nicely into a question that's popped into the chat around the politics of representation, because Rowan, your resistance to want to spectacularize or use the spectacle of the images generated from the Gwanwyck protests, one of the questions that's come in is, could you say a bit more about the divisive approach to race in the conflict? The owner of the factory was Anglo-Indian. To what extent did a right-wing agenda utilize the event towards particular hierarchies within a neo-imperialist agenda? I have a follow-up to that, but I'm going to let you answer that, and then I've got a question that connects to Mo and Peter.
Great, yeah, thanks for that question. Yeah, I think to a great extent, perhaps. I think there's a lot of writing around the kind of race politics of Gwanwyck, and so George Ward was an Anglo-Indian. He wasn't the only director as well, but he was the one who was most visible. And he worked with a group called NAF, National Association for Freedom, they were called, who were this neoliberal think tank thing, which basically brought about pre-neoliberalism, but they brought it about essentially. And they kind of backed him up in his kind of fight against the workers. I think I'm less concerned about where to assign blame and to decide who or who isn't being racist in the situation. I think there's the government inquiry, the Lord Scarman report, I think it's called, you can download it. Think it concludes there wasn't any kind of serious racial harassment or kind of oppression. Like, I think that's what they concluded. At the time, I think my interest is in, oh, actually, we'll look at the entire system, look at the way that capital works, look at the way that labor is exploited, look at the way that people are moved in and out, allowed in to countries to serve particular purposes. And I think I'm interested in that kind of systemic structural view of the, yeah, which I think is like really important for the context of Gwanwyck to understand that, and the way that like imperialism and racism, capitalism, like basically work together to construct a situation that happened at Gwanwyck. And I want to say Gwanwyck is not exceptional. It's exceptional because the it kind of blew up in a way, but in terms of its like practices as a company, even how big it was, you know, it wasn't the biggest, it wasn't the smallest. It was very kind of like a lot of other companies. And in a way, we just get this little insight because there's so much kind of publicity and interest in Gwanwyck. It gives us this real insight into what, again, is still invisible, but like is there, we can kind of grasp a little bit of what was happening. I hope that maybe answers a little bit.
I think so. I guess the follow-up to that about these kind of questions around representation, for me, Mo, the history that you depict, you present around slide tape technology, and particularly the way it was adopted by women and Black artists in the UK, and its role in sort of creating a different type of representation, you know, a precursor to video, a precursor to different types of moving image. I'm curious about how that relates to some of the sort of the fringe activity that's happening in independent photography galleries, how supportive the spaces were of those practices by marginalized artists, because there's obviously different types of activity happening in the margins. You have the networks that Peter was talking about in terms of the independent galleries, and then you have the kind of these networks of artists who are working with sort of fringe media in some ways. So I'm curious about understanding that history between the different types of media and the different types of spaces.
Mm. Well, I've researched slide tape over many years now. And one of the sentences I had to cut out of my paper was that the documentation that exists is fleeting and spread across many different spaces. But in fact, none of those I came across were photographic spaces, exclusively photographic spaces. I didn't go to the photographer's gallery, for instance, when I was doing the practical research. So in fact, it isn't a question I've thought of before in many ways, because I've always assumed there was a relationship with the photographic. But there weren't spaces made within the within photographic institutions to show this type of work. And this is what I talked about in the way in which it falls through all these different definitions. It never sat very comfortably in any of them. So it was in none of them, and maybe in some of them. It did exist in places like, say, London Filmmakers Co-op and in galleries at the start of the 80s, and in art colleges. You know, somewhere like Wolverhampton had a great reputation for producing slide tape works, hence people like Keith Piper and so on had access to that. But yet, photographic institutions, no. Perhaps it was the sound element, I assume, which would have thrown, the photographer's gallery and so on.
Can I add something into that?
Sure.
That I do think there are times that the photography galleries used sort of tape slide and sometimes it was, sorry, am I on? Yeah, I am. One of the things, of course, about the slide was it was a domestic medium, and it was used within kind of, you know, family situations to show the family archive. And it was the poor person's way of kind of projecting something out, because you couldn't afford to do something in a larger scale. So community-based organizations were using slides and slide carousels and not always as sophisticated as the tape slide in the way that mechanism that Mo's talking about is kind of aligned technologies, but it's absolutely there. And you see it, for example, in Nan Golden's family album project, which was going on into the noughties, where she's using the idea of the carousel and that very familiar, that sound, like ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk. Which is so important as a signifier of something happening, because it takes something which is a domestic medium and a relatively low cost medium into the gallery space. So when artists were using that, they were applying a technology which in some ways just that application itself is a little bit subversive and playful.
Well, that was a distinction Peter that made earlier on. Of course, there is slide projection in photography galleries and a whole long history of that, including, as you say, people like Nan Golden and so on, but not of using tape with it, slide tape. So that that was a different approach, which took it into, as I said, took it more towards film media.
I'm really conscious of time. I'm also aware that we have overrun a little bit. Although I have lots of other questions I could ask you all, I'm going to stop and take the time to thank you so much for your very, very generous presentation. They were so provocative and brought to light so many different narratives around both photographic medium, its materiality, and the networks that have sort of allowed it to become both a space and a site for activism, and as a space for us to really question the role of technology within contemporary society, the role of the image and how we use it today. I think at that point, if there's nothing else anyone wants to add in, I'm just going to take the chance to thank you all and have a lovely afternoon and the rest of the conference today.
Thanks very much, Maitreyi. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.